Good morning, ma. Welcome back to the first day of this week. Hope you enjoyed the Vinayaka Chauthi. Hope you celebrated well. Hope you got blessings from him to complete this academic year without any interventions like this. Okay. So with this wish, we will start our today's session, that is Grid and Cloud Computing, second topic. Okay. So before moving to the second topic of the first unit, I want to convey about I want to revise about the previous topics. So what we learn in the previous topics, ma? We learn about the computer paradigms in terms of centralized, parallel, distributed and cloud. Later we learn about the utility computing concept in terms of pay and use. Later we learn about the new words called as IoT and CPS, cyber physical systems. Right. So with that, today we are going to start a new topic called as a technologies for network based systems. Those computers which are able to communicate with us by using network systems, means network technologies, we are going to learn about this. All technologies needed. Why technologies we have to use for the network? Because the network is a communication, that is enough for us. If communication network is there, that is enough for us according to this heading. But we are going to use a word called as a technologies, not technology. See, for example, if you want to using a YouTube, okay, the YouTube provider have higher bandwidth, but if a mobile have very less internal space, okay, then does be able to get the stream, YouTube stream, without any intermission? No, we can't get, because the capability with your memory is very less, so that it is not able to cope up with the higher bandwidth, okay. So even though we need network technologies, or even though we going to perform some operations using networks, but whenever there is a less capacity in your storage or processing speed, then these technologies may not be available to you. These services may not be available to you in terms of grid and cloud computing. Okay. So we need other resources also for getting better service from these devices, right? So in terms of what we have to learn in terms of technologies for this heading, for network based systems in terms of grid and cloud, we have to learn about the hardware, we have to learn about the software requirements, we have to learn about the network technologies for distributed computing system designs and applications. Okay, so because these are scattered around the globe in a satellite communication without any wiring, so to get the service without any interruption in the midway, our capability should be more in terms of hardware, software and network. So for not fulfillment of this network connectivity, we need to take care of the processor, we need to take care of the memory, internal memory or external memory, we need to take care of the connectivity methodologies. Okay, right. Further, we have to use this technologies word. What the processor evolution taking place, what are the memory requirements, what are the network devices we are going to use, all this we are going to learn in this new concept 1.2. Okay, so I want to show you one diagram, the evolution diagram. Okay, the evolution diagram which gives a lot of processing capabilities, which gives a lot of network connectivity increasing from last 1984 to 2011. Okay, see this diagram. If you able to observe this, at the left side I given some CPU speed which measured in millions of instructions per second. At the right side I given some network bandwidth possibility which gives in megabits per second. Okay, so in this diagram the other given evolution from 1978 to 2011. From 1978, the network connectivity started in terms of Ethernet. Later, PDP, WAX11 given by the IBM. Later, Intel company started the good processor 286. Later, Motorola given 386, that is third processor. Next, 4-bit processor 386 or 486, we can say. Later, the Intel again given some Pentium started. Pentiums are very, very useful in terms of single core or multi core. Dual core. Okay, next one they started Pentium Pro, Pentium 3, Pentium 4, etc. etc. So at the when it came reach of 2011, we are using Core i7, means i7 process we are going to use, which can perform lot of programs at a time with more increasing capability. Okay, so what is the secret behind this more increasing capability for performing multi-core concepts? In one processor, they're going to use 100 to thousands of transistors and processors built in. Okay, built in single processor, so that any number of instructions can we do, any number of programs, any number of jobs we can do parallelly. If that is a case of evolution of processing speed, then what is the evolution of this network speed? So initially we have only Ethernet only, later we got fast Ethernet, later gigabit, later 10G, later 100G capability, giga Ethernet. Okay, so these are increasing, megabytes per bit second instruction capability is increasing day by day. Now we are in era of 2020, it is more than our estimation, right? So just here they are given in terms of megabits and gigabits, but we are in a stream of jettabytes, petabytes, yottabytes, terabytes. Okay, finally we are in jettabytes at present, the creation. So the process speed is represented in MIPS, millions of instructions per second, and the network bandwidth is represented in terms of megabits per second or gigabits per second. That's it. So I collected one picture from the Google Map to show you the evolution of the processing speed from 10 to 10 to the power of 7 by using Intel 48 core prototype, which is going to you 48 cores here. If you observe here, 1 2 3 4 5 6, okay, 1 2 3 4 6 4 24, it's like this. We have entered many cores, the architecture is like this. So this is the evolution came up from 1975 to 2015. By 2015, the number of cores are going to increase 10 to the power of 1, more than 10 to the power of 1. From 10 cores to, it is going to increase around 13-14 cores. Okay, typical power requirement 10 to the power of 2 means above 10 to the power of 3 or 4 watts, megawatts or gigawatts. Okay, frequency, instruction cycles per second, it's increasing around 10 to the power of 3 means 1000. Sequential processor performance, yes, it is going to increase from 10 to the power of 4 to again. Parallel processing is increasing. Transistors usage are increasing. Okay, so everything is going to increase from 10 to up to 10 to the power of n. Right, ma'am? So with this, what is the advances? What is the advantage with this in CPU processor increasing? With this, we can do parallelism. In what levels? We learn about 8 parallelism, right? So by using this dual core, quad core, 12 means 2 cores, quad means 4, 6 hexa or more. So 2015 given around 15 cores, but now we are in 2020. You can expect any number of cores, okay? So with this, what we can do? They can exploit parallelism in terms of instructions, multiple instructions at second, or task instructions, or task level parallelism at 1 second. How they can do? With a normal CPU, is it possible? No. With the graphics processing units only, it is possible. With what? Graphics processing units only, it is possible. Which can able to perform not only normal text data, but also can also perform audio and the video processing also effectively. But what is the difference? Both are data only. All are data only. No. The audio video required huge memory requirements, huge network bandwidth, huge processing speed. Okay. So we have to cope up all these requirements. So in order to cope up this, we are going to use a single concept called as a graphics processing units. What is that? Graphics processing unit. You have to remember this. We are going to use the CPU. No, we are going to use the GPU concept. Okay, ma? Now, semantic of a modern multi-core CPU chip using a hierarchy of caches. So, before evolution of this GPU, how the CPU is going to be used with multi-core concepts. Okay, how the CPU can able to perform the parallelism, or it can exploit parallelism in terms of task and job level. We will see this. So this is a picture we have to remember for total units. If you are not able to remember this, automatically the other concept will not be useful. Okay, why means everything we are going to done parallelly. But how this parallelism can be done is by this architecture. See, this is one processor which contains a multi cores, core 1, core 2, up to core n. Each core have its own local memory, L1 cache. That local memory called as L1. Okay, all these cores in one processor can able to communicate with another memory called as a L2 cache, which is outside of each core, but inside of one processor. Okay ma? So L1 cache is a local of core 1. L2 cache is a distributed or sharing memory between these different cores memories. And finally, if you came out from this processor, or if you want to move to any other processor which is outside of this diagram, it can able to communicate with the L3 cache, that is DRAM. Okay, so like this, we have three type of caches: L1 for local, L2 for distributing in single processor, L3 for distributing in multiple processors. So with this, we can store the present data here. We can share between the threads or process here. We can communicate with any other processor with the help of not to share your programs by using L3 cache. Hope you understood this. Let us make a move here. So both multi-core and many-core GPU or CPU using this instruction threads, multiple instruction thread. What is thread? Lightweight process. A single program. For example, my program is to do some calculation of 1 to 10 numbers. Okay. So for that, I have only one thread. That thread only have to locate the instruction. That thread only have to locate the values of or variables locations. That thread only have to perform calculations. That thread only have to make a loop from 1 to 10. The thread only have to perform summation. That thread only have to give the result. Is it easy? No, it is not easy. Of course, it can do, but a lot of time is taking. In order to overcome that, you have to use the multiple threads. Okay, if one is summing, one can get the another value. If second one is getting another value, that is incremented value, third one can replace this sum to the main variable. Okay, so all these jobs can done parallelly, so the time is going to reduce because we have multiple processors, right? So here that is used in terms of multi-threads in both multi-core and many-core CPU or GPU respectively, right? So that is the advantage of these threads. See, the author is explaining regarding this diagram. Each core is essentially processor with its own private cache. Yes, I explained. Multiple cores are housed in a same chip with an L2 cache, multiple cores in a single processor. And finally, an L3 cache or DRAM is off the chip as shown above. Off the chip means it is not available in the same chip but in different chip. You have multiple chips in a single computer. Okay. So what is the advantage of this multi-core and many-core? It contains tens or hundreds of cores in a single computer, which can be useful in data level parallelism constraints. It can avoid this. It can move to not only data, it can move to instruction, job, task also. Okay. So this has triggered the development of many core GPUs with hundreds or more thin cores. Right. So this is the invention given around i386 and 486 previously, 32-bit and 64, around 2005 it seems, not now, 2005. So after 15 years of evolution, we came lot of advancements in this. Okay, at that time only with 86 processors, when I am going to do BTech, they are going to use HPC and the HTCR, 2004. But now after 16 years, we can do lot of concepts. So at that time they are going to use RISC, reduced instruction set computers, which are not fulfill present requirements. So they moved from RISC to CISC, okay, so which can help for massively parallel processing applications in supercomputers of large clusters of cloud computing. Okay ma, next. So I given some, I use the word RISC here. So a lot of you may be thinking why RISC is not better when compared to CISC. So what is CISC? Is complex instruction set computer. What is the RISC? Is reduced instruction set computer. If you observe this, it is prominent on the software useful, but it can be useful on the hardware also. It have low cycles, but it have more cycles per second. More transistors are used for storing memory. Less transistors are used to do operations on complex instructions. They are going to use this load and store by using registers. See, what is the drawback with the registers is they are going to do these operations very fastly, but we have limited registers. We can't extend our operation more than these registers. If we want to use multiple instructions execution, we can't perform. So what they are going to use? Memory. The memory is unlimited, depends upon your capability of investment amount. We can get any amount so that we can perform operations. And this clock is single clock. It is one of the main drawback. Means it is a totally centralized one. All have to fall at one place. But no need. We can do multiple clocks for different applications. So for these advantages, they preferred CISC instead of RISC. Multi-threading technologies. Yes, very, very important. I just use a word thread, which can be useful for to do parallel works. So one program can be divided into multiple process. Multiple process can be useful or can be performed by using multiple threads. So we have five types of methodologies which are going to use different concepts, in terms of threading. See, if you just have to have a glance of these words: four issue, fine grain, coarse grain, two core and simultaneous. Four issue is going to use only single thread. Fine grain is going to use multiple threads for different instructions by a single thread. Okay, multiple threads for different instructions. But here multiple instructions can also be performed by single thread. Possibility is there. I mean, different type of data also can be accepted by single thread. Here different cores for different applications. We have a number of processors here. Number of processors with multiple threads are here. We will see this in this architecture. Just try to have a concentration on this diagram. So it is a cycle. We have four functional units here. It is 1, 2, 3, and 4. So these are nothing but the threads. We have five types of threads here. Its slot is empty. Five types of threads here. This is one type, second type, third type, fourth type, and fifth type. Okay, so every concept have four functional units which are doing operation based upon the cycle. So in the first one, they're going to use only single thread, total single thread. Okay, so that single thread only have to perform a instruction execution. So it's a total wasting of time. As this thread is not available to do some other functions, all these white boxes are empty. Means we can't schedule any execution at this time, so that they are going to be idle, so that the performance is going to be very, very less. If we move to fine grained multi-threaded processor, means we are going to use multiple threads in one cycle. In one cycle from top to bottom, if you are going to move, we are going to use different threads here. 1, 2, 3, and 4 threads are going to use. So what is the use of this? We are going to use a different threads for single instruction. Of course, I mean different threads are performing a single instruction works, which I said previously. Advantage. Next, if you see this coarse grain, it is very, very useful. This single thread. See, this single thread can also be useful for different applications. Switching is going to do. Okay, so this one is going to do in other works. Switched by another thread, switched by another thread, switched by another thread, switched by another thread. very fast they are switching these threads. Okay, it's very very useful advancement. If you observe this, we have two different codes separately. One is used totally by one application, another by another application, with only single threads here. Okay, with only single threads here. Finally, simultaneous multi-thread. Different threads can perform at one functional unit. If you observe this, all these functional units which are performing some operation using the same thread. Here also same thread, same thread, same thread, same thread, same thread. But if you observe here, multiple threads for multiple functional units. So any thread can be useful for any function. There is no limit in this. So what is the advantage of this? With this, any thread is available for at present means we have to use this for our instruction. There is no constraint in this. If you observe in the first diagram, we have a lot of empty slots because unavailability of the threads. Here some slots are reduced, here some reduced, here also some reduced. It depends upon the core, don't worry. If you observe this, we have very less empty slots here. Okay, so if very less empty slots means the CPU can do lot of works parallelly, so the time is going to be used efficiently. Okay, at a single point of time we can do parallel processing by using number of processors, number of threads execution. Okay ma, so this is advantage of this concept, multi core with multiple threads. Okay, so in the next class we will learn about a new concept and extension. We have extension also about this, but for today that is enough. Okay, bye ma, have a nice day.